very good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to welcome you all to the first ever program of the Great Minds for the year 2020, organized by the Future Marketers Association of the Department of Marketing Management of University of Kalania. I am Cindy De Silva. I will be your moderator for the day. The Great Minds series was initiated with the pure intention of bringing the country's greatest personalities, the highest achievers in the country, to share their insights, their experience, the do's and don'ts, and their personal experience so that you can get the exposure and be corporate ready. So even though this is not the usual setup or this is not the usual way we conduct this executive series, we at Future Marketers Association, we don't stop at anything. So here we have today a very special guest with us. She is the first female group CEO of a public quoted conglomerate in Sri Lanka and one of the top 12 women change makers in the country in year 2019. Let's have a look at who this is. Continue with today's proceedings, I would like to invite our head of the department of the Department of Marketing Management, Dr. Ravi Dissanayake, to officially welcome the gathering. Sir, over to you.
Okay, Aibon everyone, good afternoon. And it's another great day for Department of Marketing Management and even the Future Marketers Association. And today I'd love to see this presence of all first year, second year and third year students. And my first courtesy goes to our speaker coming from the presence of the practice scenario that we all love to have academics and practice together. And thank you very much for accepting our invitation, Ms. Kasturi Selvaraj, and being a leadership icon for one of the brilliant companies in Sri Lanka. It's a local conglomerate. That's also another good thing for us to have you into the forum. And thank you very much, Kasturi, and accepting our students' invitation and make you a valuable presence. I think second time, I guess, right? You are no more visitor, but I love to see you are with designations. And of course, what we always advise to students, future marketers, that we name it as future marketers because that's their the future, of course, the country's future as well. And Department of Marketing Management, that's what the culture and the professionalism we maintain as a state university. Our main aim is the knowledge, education first. So that has to be our core. But however, we are equally valuing the emerged truth that is called the discipline, what goes with the values. So we are not producing graduates. We always try to produce characters to the country and the corporates and where they have to have a self-learning. So I always believe as the head of the department and with my renowned faculty, the contribution what the university should do for students is not that limited to what is said to be the pedagogy and the evaluation methods. And the corporate sector and the government sector, specifically education sector, have to work together. Then only the impact comes. It's learning from corporate sector people, from academic institutes like us, and of course we to learn from corporate. That's win-win learning scenario always. So thank you very much, Senali, the leadership you brought with the Future Marketers Board of Directors and all the students who got this as one of the very valuable inputs to their never-ending learning. Even we also learn from corporate sector because learning has no boundary. And today I love to learn as much as time permits me. And Kasturi, very much thanking again for your courtesy you made to the university. And of course, keep your calendar free, diary free. I know it's fully packed with the works. However, I believe you also take this as a responsibility. Thank you very much, Kasturi, your presence once again. And Ms. Kasturi will definitely give good insights for our future marketers because that's our motto, crafting strategist. There you are. Please go ahead with the fruitful session ahead.
Thank you, sir. Ms. Kasturi Chelaraja Wilson is an alumni of Holy Family Convent, Bambalapitiya, and a fellow of the Chartered Institute of Management Accountants at United Kingdom. She has attended many leadership programs over the course of her career, most remarkably the Senior Executive Leadership Program at Harvard Business School. In a career spanning two decades at HEMAS, Kasturi has held many senior management positions in becoming the Chief Process Officer. And thereafter, in 2011, she took on the leadership of aviation, travel, and mobility businesses of the group. In 2016, she led the HEMAS Pharmaceuticals. She serves as a board member of Capital Alliance Limited, Morrisons PLC, and HEMAS Consumer Brands, and is currently the president of Sri Lanka Chamber of the Pharmaceutical Industry, and also the first woman to be holding this position. It is with great honor I welcome our guest speaker for the day, Ms. Kasturi Chelaraja Wilson, as she will be sharing her insights gained with experience on how one can perform in a challenging corporate environment. Ms. Kasturi, this invitation goes out to you.
Thanks. Thank you. And first of all, thank you, Dr. Ravi, for actually giving an opportunity for a corporate to work with or individuals to work with the university. I think that's a very important part of it. Thank you, Shanali, for I think you've done a good job in getting everybody here and understanding that it's important to be here. I think what Dr. Ravi said is so important, that academic is one aspect. There is so much of a rounded personality you need to get, which is, this is the future, y'all are the future of Sri Lanka. And if you ask me why I spend time, is A, I need to give back, because a lot of people gave to me, so I need to give back. And I believe that if we don't change the minds or influence at the university stage, because changing the structure in the university is tough, as at least if we can bring the practical element to the graduates, y'all will be better placed to succeed. So your topic was, how do you succeed in challenging environments? Simple thing is, I think the more challenges you have in your personal life and life in general makes you more resilient and makes you more capable of surviving in a corporate life. The reason I managed to navigate corporate, I wouldn't say succeed, navigate and do what I'm doing, is because I faced a lot, and I faced it not knowing it was a challenge. I just took it as it came. Three things I believe is in, as young people, I would urge you all to spend time to figure out, to understand what you all are good at. It may be one thing, it may be two things, but it won't be the same thing of what, if you and somebody else are thinking about it, it both won't have the same thing. You have to find one or two things what you're good at. If not, find what you're passionate about. That's first lesson. Second lesson I learned very early on is, you can't succeed on your own. You have to learn to work with others, collaborate, learn to understand that sometimes when you all are working in teams, somebody else will take the limelight. It's okay, but you have a role to play in it. And you have competencies you bring to the table. I understand that's dovetailing to the first one I said. Third one is being open to change. Don't be locked in that mindset of, I'm a marketeer and I presume you all are in marketing and management, hence I'm not going to be open to anything else, because sometimes that change will open some other doors, and I'll try to take you through some of my key highlights, which I blindly went in through at a risk of failing. And last of all, I think your Dr. Ravi did allude to it. Life is a journey, always a journey of learning. And I just did my CIMA early on, but after that I never did my MBA, because I believe that my kids needed my time, and I said, no, I can't waste my time doing an MBA. But when I was about 48, I did went to Harvard and did this advanced management program, which was equal to some. And for me, it was like, okay, at that age, I was scared going into study at that time and studying at Harvard. I thought, wow, am I going to fail here? But, you know, be open to it. So on knowing your what your value is, I learned very early in school. It was not because of my academy. I was good in math. Having said that, I was not bad in studies. I just didn't bother about it, right? But I knew I was valuable to the school because I was very good at sports. So I knew I was valuable. So that, because of that, you would find when I passed my O-levels, there was no math stream in Tamil. But the principal created a classroom only for me, one employer, one student. So because I was valuable to them, I was playing, I was captaining netball, basketball, whichever. As I left school, within a week, I was chosen, I was invited to join an audit firm. Because I did double math physics chemistry and I didn't have, unlike, I think most of you all know what you all like and what you want to do. Some of you all like will be like me, don't have a clue what you want to do and what you want, what you, where you want to end up in a career. But I was passionate about succeeding in life. Succeeding what I do, that was sports at that time. It didn't have a material number to me. I didn't want to live in big houses and stuff, but I wanted to play and win and do be excellent, right? So happened they recruited, they invited me to play netball for the firm. But me being me, when I went in and started doing learning auditing from a theory, from a practical sense, I didn't have a clue about theory. I asked all the questions and learn it properly. So the lesson is whatever the role is, you will get opportunities for internships on your first job. Ask million questions so that you know what you're doing and make sure that you're excellent at it. Because you can't look at the next job when you're not getting thorough here. So that was something I learned. And in my life, it had been that. And I ended up becoming an accountant because your time, our time dragging was really bad. And for all my courage, I saw my sister getting ragging and my day at Colombo campus, I didn't get maths, I didn't get engineering, I got physical science. It lasted like 2 hours, I think, or 15 minutes, all of it. Somebody tried to rag me and I went home and that was it. And I qualified because I owed it to my mother. So to all of you all, don't think it's a waste. If you're doing it for your parents, you wouldn't believe it will come in use. And you owe it to yourself to get some qualification. So when I chose not to go full-time work because I got married very early in life. And I, as at that time, I preferred to be a full-time mom or part-time mom. And that was a choice I made. But even in that job, by that time, I knew what I was good at. So I know even though I was in audit firm, if they had one cash flow, nobody could tell you, it'll come to me. And in 15 minutes, I would tell you it. So you knew what your USP was. And during the sports, because of sports, I learned very early in life that you can't succeed on your own. I would have been the world's best or Sri Lankan's best shooter or HFC's best shooter at that time. But that wouldn't have made any sense if our defense was not playing, if my center was not bringing the ball and giving it to me. And it's a humbling experience. You can be the best. But you're as strong as your name, your team strength. So in today's environment, when we are naturally competing, naturally there's so much of friction and infighting, I would urge you all as a younger generation, leave that behind. Leave your caste, religion, everything behind. Think about the country. Think about working together, because only when you all work together can the results come. And I love working with the younger people in offices because for them it's about job getting done. You have the older generation, it's about why is that one doing it and why am I not doing it? And there's so much of politics. And sometimes even if you're sitting as a leader, you have the least amount of control when you have to influence so many people. So when I all this time when I was when I had my kids and stuff, there were challenges. Not that it was easy. There were challenges, but you face it, you manage it. And by when I was 30, I went into full-time work simply because I had to provide for my kids. I became a single mom, and that came with a different lot of challenges. But because I knew what I was good at, I remember when I was interviewed at Hema's, I told them, look, I'm good at my job. And I could tell that because I knew damn well I'll do it better than somebody else. I'll figure out the answers. I'll train people. But I told them, I'm a mother first. And because of that, I'm a single mother. it was tough even saying those words, because society was waiting to hammer the woman in everything, saying, you know, you're a single mom. I'm sure, I mean, it's still in this generation, the fault goes to the woman. I'm not saying the fault was the man either. It's just that nobody gets married to end up in a divorce. So people shouldn't be judging. But luckily I had a company which didn't judge. They only said, Kasturi, your kids come first, we respect it. So it allowed me to really work. So I was there supported. Even, I mean, people who don't know my story, I mean, I think they all should know by now that when I was studying for my SIMA, I didn't have money for SIMA. I came from a family where my mom only worked, my father didn't work. My father was a stay-at-home dad because you all are young kids and you all will have your own family problems. My father used to love alcohol more than he loved in a way of working. And because of that, my mother did 3 jobs. So when it came to my education, my job, my boss at Somesuran told me that the company would pay for it. But again, they didn't pay because they felt sorry for me. They paid because I was valuable. Today in our organization, when I see talented people as an organizer, not only me, everybody, we would support a talented kid who doesn't have means just to make them succeed. So I'm telling you this, if you all have talent, own it. Figure out what you're good at and be proud of it. You don't need to talk, have the best of English and be able to communicate. They only want results. We have evolved around it, right? So then when I moved into HEMAS, within 3 years, I kind of was moved to set up shared services. I didn't know that space. I was just told, go and set it up and on an ERP platform and stuff. And that was meaning I was moving out of my core strength, finance. Remember, I didn't like finance. I didn't like being an accountant. I thought it was the most boring job on earth. But I was very good at it. And it paid my salary. And it was, my kids were fed because of it. So I would love, you know, either you love your job because you know that's what makes you tick. Or you love your job because you're good at it and somebody praises you. So somebody used to praise me. So then you're more motivated, even though it's the most boring job. Then I moved, and at one point I found it very boring, and the shared service, I told my boss, look, I might have to move out because I was getting job offers, and he said no, and he told me to run group IT and process. I was changing from finance to that. It was a huge challenge, and it was a huge risk as well, because you have your kids, what if you fail? But I guess coming from sports and going through so much of challenges in life, you think this is another one. All I know is when I'm putting a deep end, I would swim. I won't swim alone. I'll get help from others. So in that form, the help I got was I got people who were better than me who worked for me. So I learned from them. And then you might ask the question, or all of you will think, so that means Kasturi didn't have any role to play. She was just there as a figurehead. No. My strength at that point I knew was getting teams to work together. And when everybody is running all over the show with different ideas, I have an ability of cutting through, understanding. I came from operations and I say, hold on, let's step back. This seems to be the way to go. So one, people used to give me feedback, you take the clutter out of the mess and make it simple. So I knew that was a strength because people told me. So what I'm telling you is over time, keep always listening to people, questioning them, what do you think I'm good at? Try to enhance what you're good at. There'll be 1,000 things you're not good at. There are 1,000 things I'm not good at. And in life, as normal human beings, you're willing to find, you're always waiting to find fault in that one black dot in a white wall. I always say, so why are we talking about the black dot? I'm not going to change a human being from tomorrow. She's not going to become this, or he's not going to be this, but he's strong in this, this, and this. Why don't we make them succeed that way? So I was one of the lucky ones. I had an organization which allowed us to be ourselves and thrive. And at that time, we were smaller, so the family members saw me, and I would be one of those who were too straight. So these are feedback I got. Very tough to work with Kasturi. She's too straight. She's too aggressive. She wants things done too fast. It was a lot of that. But end of the day, there was also the pluses saying, you know, she's one person. If you give something, it's effectively done. She'll push you to be the best you can be. But over time, I also had to tone my ways of managing stuff to allow others to grow. So I changed over time. Every time I can't think I'm right. There were a million times I made mistakes and I was the first to own up and say I'm wrong. And, you know, you grow that way. So when I first went into the role of MD in 2011, I had a coach. It's not that I automatically walked into the role. So the point there is you need some support to adjust your style in different circumstances. And there I finished 5 years. Of course, the business grew. Then I went into pharma. And pharma, I didn't know the industry at all. I was not from that industry. But there I was given one mandate saying, go and get the best out of the workforce. We had a fabulous team and somehow they were not motivated to work. So that was and for me that played to my strength. So that's how my pharma role happened. But it could have been that I could have actually failed, because within 3 months of getting into pharma, the government decided to put price control and you had 20% of your revenue going out of the P&L. You had a huge loss because up to now, I'm not sure why that government didn't put a price mechanism, which I mean is when the exchange moves up, your price has to move. So we had losses. And I thought, my God, I'm going to fail this job. And amazingly, what gave me the strength is I remember sitting with the Exco 3 months into job. I said, look, this problem I can't solve overnight. How do we find a solution and succeed in spite of it? This is like COVID. Now, COVID is not going to go away. How are you all going to learn? How are you all going to be getting jobs? And how are you all going to be relative for the economy in spite of COVID? So we had this problem. So they asked me what? I said, only way I can think of is bring in more revenue to take through the fixed cost. We can eliminate some costs and stuff so that you achieve the same bottom line. So the first question is, I said, do we change our bottom line and tell the board now we are losing this permanently? That was about 300, 400 million from the profit. And naturally, I'm very competitive. I must be very honest. I said, no, I don't want to do that. Can we find a solution? Every problem has a solution, but I don't know the answers. And then I said, okay, one way is putting more into the revenue line. And each one said, okay, I'll do this, I'll do this. Each one took a role. And too fast track 2 years later, you have a market share going from 22% to 33%, where the number two stacked at 10%. We had we got the best in class principals to move to us because we were forced to be excellent. Nobody's just going to shift. We had to force to be excellent. We were forced to use the digital. So the point being is we had to understand how it was relevant. And each one had to play a role. And each one's role was based on their strengths. So now what does that mean to you? You all are still at university. Remember, you have certain skills, you have certain aptitudes you have, and you have a degree, but your degree would lend itself to the first entry into a job, maybe. But beyond that, be free enough to see, ask questions beyond that job and open doors for the other, for your next job. What is more important is your attitude. We can train the skill, your passion. The digital side of it is very important. Wanting to do more through digital and not looking at traditional forms. But the most important thing we are expecting from the younger generation to push back with a curious mind. Our schooling system just taught us to think answers. We used to memorize, I think, and go and tell the answer. That doesn't give you creativity. So you all have to be open to think about practical stuff. Think like the consumer, push back, and push the businesses to do better. So where I sit now, yes, I've grown, my kids have grown. I had an organization which allowed talent to succeed. We don't call it gender anymore. We say we are gender blind. Recently, I was telling, sit as CEO, the CGO is a lady. And there were lots of women at the top. And I said, if I get a CFO is a lady, it's like, it's all women. Will I be looking as biased? So my chairman said, we are gender blind. Anybody who is talented, remember that's how you got here. Now don't start bringing it. And I thought, yes, am I being unfair because I'm, you know, not being blind. So get into organizations or a boss who will allow you to thrive. Don't overthink it. So basically, if you have a boss who allows you to grow, that's the first level. You get skills and you move through. So that's it. And I must say, I have had zillions of challenges. I have failed millions of times. But because of that, I learned lessons. So whether you have personal challenges or you feel you don't have opportunities, remember somebody will lend a helping hand and take it. In my life, I'm not shy to say a lot of people helped me in my life. And that's why I play it forward. In some ways, these days you don't see me too much in public space forums because I took a call to give back to universities. So these 2 years, it'll be only working with universities. Simply because I think y'all are the ones we need to attract. HEMAS particularly, we have started a turnaround plan. In that, I've said, get rid of these traditional management trainees. I want a mix of smart people from all the campuses. Give them room to talk and say anything, but execute. And license to work with any MD. I hope it works. So I'm trying to structure that. At that time, I'll reach out to your Dr. Ravi to try and get us some talent from y'all and the different unis so that, and we'll try to see. So I will pause at that. I will try not to. So only thing you can see is I moved from a maths person who ended up doing practical accounting. Then I did the theory. And I found that very much easier to relate because I was practically working when I was studying. I moved into finance. And after that, I moved into IT. I've been in industries from logistics to aviation to manufacturing, whatever. Then I went into a business leader's role in different industries. And now I'm here. So you can see that you have to be open to opportunities. You will have self-doubt. If your boss believes in you, sometimes that's worth the risk. That's worth it to take the risk. So, yeah. You're on silent.
So if anyone has questions, they can turn on their mic and video and ask them. Or if not, you can drop them in the chat box and I will read it out to Ms. Kasturi. I have a question for Ms. Kasturi. You've done a lot of sports in your schooling days and you're always still very enthusiastic about sports. I think these extracurricular activities have molded your personality in becoming competitiveness. What do you think is lacking in the younger generation now? They think that if you do this, that if you do sports or if you are going to do extracurricular, we're going to lack in studies. What is this mentality? What is the advice you can give to them?
So you're hitting a good question. So when I work with my school prefects or the sports, their parents say, if you do sports, you're going to get distracted from studies. Remember, studies are book academics. In life to succeed, you have to be street smart. You have to have life lessons with you. And that comes from academic side of it. So the biggest lessons I learned from sports is, look, you can't become excellent overnight. So I would have to practice every day. I would have woken up at 5 o'clock, no shortcuts. And every day you do the same thing, you repeat, you start improving once you repeat it. So you learn that discipline. That is, you learn it in the school, in the sports field. But in the textbook, you only learn the theory, saying that you do it 10 times, you can get excellent, but you never try it. Here you do it 1,000. I used to be having to do 1,000 shots a day. And in my mind, if I do 999, I'm not happy. So I do the 1,000 shots. And by that, my job was to shoot, so I would do the 1,000 shots. And the second thing sports gives is, it allows you to connect with people. It keeps you grounded. It gives you that thing of, you can be up and down in life. People from different walks of life still have skill. So, and different backgrounds, we still have skill. So it allows you to integrate with people. It actually gives you ability to be humble, and it's a blessing to be humble. And most of all is you learn to navigate life. It's a lot of, it's not easy doing that because you're learning to balance a lot of things. So then do you mean that you neglect education? I don't think so. I mean, I did 3 sports. I would have not focused that much on education, but I made sure that I passed my O-level. I didn't get into engineering, but at least I got into something. I think you have to learn to focus on both. From a corporate point of view, I'll be very honest. When we interview, we scan through your education a bit. beyond that, I would always ask and look at, I think Facebook or Google is doing, they're not recruiting graduates. They're just recruiting people ordinary, I mean, without any graduate degrees, because they want people with life skills. So what I ask is, tell me an instant where you have helped somebody or where you have worked with the team and the team has won. So we want to see how you are as a person. What else interests you? Are you passionate about the planet? Are you passionate about technology? Are you passionate about culture, traveling? You know, we need people who are passionate about other things other than this. So it's very important. It's not too late. On the other side, the sports side, I personally feel exercise is important to all of us. Because if you look at Sri Lanka during COVID, I'm telling you all because you all have parents and you all have to look after your own health as well. 70% of our people have some form of NCT, that is diabetes, cholesterol, and pressure. So these are things you get due to lifestyle. Some are hereditary, most of it is lifestyle, what you eat, how you exercise, how do you look after yourself. So I exercise now, every day I exercise, purely because I want to have my mental strength, because that gives me my blood flowing clarity. And also I like to feel healthy. So I think it's important.
Thank you so much. So it's, I think we have a question from Asita. I will read it out for Ms. Kasturi. Just give me a second. All right. Ms. Kasturi, on your point of view, what matters the most? Is it experience or the talent? Or the talent and skill to climb the corporate ladder in Sri Lanka corporate context? Like, what he's asking is whether the education is what's important or the talent and skills, but on your, from your point of view.
My point of view, I think the talent, the attitude, the fact that you are passionate about getting things done the right way, the skill of understanding problems, problem solving, analytics and stuff like that, whether you're good in analyzing stuff. But those are what matters, and performance. So technically, who are passionately wanting to perform and deliver results are things we will look at. Education is one aspect of it. Beyond that, everything else, beyond that is, it's only the entry has that education filter. After that, it's all your skill and talent and how you perform, how do you work with others, how do you contribute, and most importantly, the passion you bring to the table. Somebody has asked,
we have another question from...
How do you manage to gather the so much of courage, and how do you handle yourself in a stressful situation? So now stress is within you, right? Okay, I'll ask you, when there are situations, first question you have to ask is over time, right? So why are you stressed out about the situation? Because these elements are things which I'm not comfortable with. Then I have to ask yourself, can you change it? If you can change it, get stress, sort out it, put all your stress in changing it. If you can't change it, no point stressing about it. You have to figure out a way of surviving or working, doing alternate. So that's how you, I mean, it's not only work. I think there's stress in life. So I have one mantra, if anything is on my mind, I talk about it. So even with my bosses, if I have need their support, I'll talk. To my management, I'll talk. Bringing up two sons was not easy. Some days their reports were bad and I'm stressed. So I will go and tell my boss, look, I have to spend time with my sons because their reports are not good. I need to make sure they're studying that, this. But I'm honest about it and I have communication. So leave, share the stress. When you share it with others, it's less stressful. And don't stress about things you can't control, because anyways, you can't control it.
Great. Should I read out the questions or?
Yes. Yeah, you
all do. Right, sure. And then Vishmi has another question from Ms. Kasturi. What are the strategies that can help women achieve more prominent roles in the organization? Because we still lack in Sri Lanka. We still have some of the gender inequalities, not in HEMAS, but in other corporates. What are the kind of tips or advices that you would like to share for the women here today?
So there are two aspects to it. One is you'll need to be convinced that these roles are gender neutral. So I remember when I was when this MD of transportation came up, I was a functional head. I was a CPO, chief process officer till then. And transportation is logistics, maritime. And I'm like, did my boss, but that's like a male dominant thing. And he said, yeah, but I don't want you to go and do it the way they do it. I want you to do it the way you do it. You can do it. And we believe this role is for this competency and not a gender. We have to believe. If the organization is not ready for it, you have to believe it. I had the inverse. The organization was ready. I doubted it the first time around. Second thing is, look, there might be at points in time you want to take a break or slow down because you have your family. And that's normal. So we support women to take time off, their flexi because of family commitments, because we know we can't solve their problems at home. We can only enable them to succeed. So I think the conversation, you all, I would urge you all is figure out the roles you like, and because it's because of your strength or something like that. Or don't say no to a very perceived non-female role. Be bold enough to take it if somebody offers it. Second thing is, if you are interested in the role and you still have other commitments and you need some support from the organization, have a conversation about it. Tell your boss, look, these are the things, but can I come at 9 o'clock because I'll let me drop my kid and come, but I will catch up, don't worry about my outcome. Fine, have a conversation. So I guess there are most organizations are changing. It's because now we need the best people in the workforce, and so happens there are a lot of good women out there. So the world is changing. Y'all are in a different league now. And don't think of yourself as a woman. That's all I would say. Think of yourselves as another individual. I'm not telling you to act like a man. That's not my thing. But just take that word out of your head and think about the job and think whether you can get it done. And be a bit more confident though. Be a bit more assertive, because being softer, the guys kind of talk a bit louder. But I must tell this to the guys as well. No role is not good for you or not relevant for you. See whether it's aligned to your skills, something you're passionate about. Because sometimes now when you have careers, you will have families. And in order for the family life to succeed, you will have to do some co-parenting. And at HEMAS, we encourage that. We want the men to take a bit more of a share of work. But have the conversations and learn to share work. Don't be against working with others. It's amazing how you can get teams to work together.
We have so many questions coming up from Ms. Kasturi. Everyone's very curious. We will go with Ms. Shanika's question. I have a similar question. How did you balance work and life? How do you draw the line? Because I think it's one thing that most people are struggling to draw the line, where work is work and life. You need to draw the line. How do you draw the line?
So I had to, there are a few things. First of all, you have to figure out what makes you happy. What is that balance of happiness, fulfillment you'll have? So the work is, the thing is, I never balanced it. I didn't balance home front and work. It was a perfect imbalance. Some days I would overly focus on work because I knew it was critical that I had to succeed on those days, or I had some responsibility. When family, I knew I had to be there for my kids, I would have taken excessive time with them. So in your heart, you'll know what balance to take, which will make you happy. It's all about what you can live with. And after making those choices, you have to live with it. In all this with work and kids, what makes me very neutral and makes me grounded is my exercise time. So I was not willing to compromise it. Whatever happened, that 1 hour, I had to put it whichever, in the evening or morning, because I knew that's what makes me happy. So you need to figure out those recipes, and then you mix it according to day to day. It will be a challenge. And when your kids grow up, it's a different thing. Now my kids, both kids are in Australia. And what do I do? My balance is like only exercise and work and my friends. So you have to get balance to fill your mind, your body, and your soul. and soul is spiritual, and people, good people around you to keep you grounded. And nowhere will I tell you to just commit to work only. So you have to figure out other things which interest you and you love. And then you make the choice.
All right. We have another question from Tatsarani. How is your professional life? How does your professional life influence in personal life, and personal life affect your profession? I think that's the question that you answered previously as well. How do you manage time with your professional and personal life that leads you into excel in your career? Can you share some tips? Time management. I think this question
time
goes.
Doing what I love. So I never did a job which I didn't like. If I didn't like it, I would have walked out of it. So you have to do well in your job to like it. If you even think you like the area and you don't like the job because of the environment, you have to figure out something and move out. So because I was having the license to have conversations with my boss if I didn't like it. And don't say that, I don't think for a moment that I didn't have issues. I had. There is always issues. There'll be the more you grow, there is competitiveness among people around. And how you handle that is important. So I had two kids, so I would have gone and had a conversation with their boss and said, look, you let me know how the rules are here, because I would make a choice if not. And, you know, it's no point keeping things to yourself. So that's just generally what I would say. Yeah.
We have a very interesting question from Sampat. I think it's like a situation. Ms. Kasturi, we thought Ms. have two employees for an interview. One employee has 10 years of experience without any academic or professional qualifications, and the other has a lot of professional and academic qualifications regarding to marketing. Which one do you select as your employee? What are the points you analyze in both of them? I mean, what is the basis? So one, I think what...
Both yes. have their merits. So I would attack the one with experience to see, with all that experience, what type of knowledge or what type of intuition has he got. So if it's a marketing, I'll say, how do you get consumer insight? How would you look at this thing? If there's a problem like this, how would you attack it? So he'll come with a lot of practical skills. From the academic person, I would say, okay, so but how do you relate to it practically to understand whether he understands it? More or less, the person with experience, and if he's a smart guy with experience, he would trump it, because we value people who have gone and invested and done jobs as well. But if it's a guy with academics who has invested in learning about consumers, interested in the world out there, he also would have performed. If it is just academic, definitely it would be tough. Unless it's just an entry-level job for people to try, then we give them a chance, because we wouldn't know until we give them a chance, right? So there is always that.
There's a very interesting question from Rashmi. That was a question I had in mind too. What would you tell your 21-year-old self? What advice would you give your 21-year-old self?
My 21-year-old self was... you shouldn't be too naive. I was very naive. I believed in everybody. And maybe it's good to trust, but maybe it's good to generally actually have some space as well. So I guess that's generally what I would give myself. Don't be an open book for too many people, too many things. Interesting question.
Great. Okay, so I think we'll go for our last question. There are so many. If you would like to pick, if you can see the questions, you would.
I said, C1, how did you manage to overcome the hardships you've gone through? It's like this, right? You put it in context to what others also go through. So what did I go through? Yes, I had a struggle with childhood. We didn't have excess money. That's fine. But we had a roof, we ate. When I went toured in with other teams, I wouldn't have pocket money because my mother couldn't afford it. But I didn't need it. I was going on a tour. How you look at it, right? Yes, I was blessed with two kids, and I was healthy, and I had a job, and I had my parents. I mean, you count your blessings. So each time something happens, I kind of step back and think, you know, there are people out there who don't have a roof, who hardly have money to eat. They've got some loved one who is really sick, somebody who is really sick. I mean, not the old people, but maybe you have a kid who is sick, or your husband or wife. They have problems, right? They don't have, so when you relate it to that, you kind of count your blessings, and you're guaranteed to in life to have challenges. I as no point, that's how you walk in life. As long as you can live today as a decent human being and know if you, tomorrow, if you pass away, you have impacted people. I guess that's all. Don't overthink it. Reach out for people for help. Even now, when I travel, when I used to travel, my mom lives with me and she has dementia, but my friends will all take turns to come and see her. And if she falls sick, one of them away, one of them would take her to the hospital. I mean, that's how you create a network, because I would do this for anybody else. So create real relationships and do it unconditionally. Don't do it for something else, and do it and be good human beings. I mean, and it's all about being a decent person, and don't be extreme on either side of it. And how you count your blessings every day. So I guess that's a lot of part of value is succeeding. Remember, we are human beings, and there's humanity around us. And I just wish Sri Lanka can be a better country together. So you all have a part to play in it. And that's it. So the problems are it's relative to something else. So some other people have bigger problems, I guess. So look at it. But of course, there are problems. I mean, I'll give you one example. There was this young guy I interviewed long years back when I was at transportation. Myself and my other director, Shanaz, were sitting. And he came and sat at that interview and he scowled. He didn't bother answering anything. And I was like, I'm prodding him with questions. And he's like, yeah, one monosyllable, right? And I'm looking at this and thinking he had got A for maths. He has given up. He's doing his degree at ACDB. That also he has given up. He doesn't have answers. So we let him go. But something bothered. Both of us looked at each other and said, what's wrong with that kid? Why did he behave like this? And we got HR to call that child and ask, why did we want to know why you were not interested in this? And why were you scowling and angry? And, you know, he turned on and said, you know, this is my father lost everything for the tsunami. And I had to give up school to work and teach, pay for my kids, my brothers. Then finally, I collected enough money to do my ACBT or something like that. And something else happened in life. And he has to give that up. So then we told him, you better leave. Everybody has problems. We told HR to tell him, come back for a second interview. This time come positively, we'll see. And the second time he came positively, we gave him a job, but we told him we'll watch his watch where he performs. And today he's a senior manager doing extremely well. He's married and we supported his education because we knew his background. But, you know, it's how you keep your problem and how you approach it. So that's life.
All right. I think this would be the last question for Ms. Kasturi. It's a question from Lakna. What do you think is the most effective? Is it working hard or working smart?
Working smart and effectively, but committed.
Okay.
You have to commit and work smart.
All right. So is there any other questions? Anyone wants to turn on their mic and ask from Ms. Kasturi? With the limited time, we can only ask one more question.
Somebody has asked, what are the opportunities available for graduates? So today's budget, I was at the meeting in the morning, and there are a lot of incentives for entrepreneurs to come go through. So maybe that's one aspect. For corporates also, there'll be lots of new spaces. But what we'll be looking at are these young tech savvy, as in I don't want you to be coding and stuff, but who will get into projects, willing to learn about operations, to drive projects across, drive transformation projects, and just be ready to roll up your sleeves and learn anything which is thrown at you, right? And there'll be enough opportunities for young, smart, committed people who are willing to work. Yeah.
All right. With that, we have come to the conclusion of today's program. On behalf of the Future Marketers Association and the Department of Marketing Management, and on behalf of everyone who are here today participating, I would like to thank Ms. Kasturi Chalaraja-Wilson for being with us today. Despite your very busy schedule, we know that you're a very busy personality, and it is truly an honor to have you with us today. So thank you so much. We are hoping to stay connected with you and have you in our future programs as well. So with that, we will be concluding our program today. So until we meet with insightful discussions like this, wear your mask, stay indoors, and stay safe. Goodbye, everyone.
Bye. Be safe. Thanks.
You too, Mr.